Hope Windward Ohana. Thank you so much for joining us online today. We hope you're having a great week. So wherever you're at, please stand to your feet and join us as we give some praise and worship to God today. Amen.
Over. everything that you have spoken will come to pass. Let it be
Redeemer, our cornerstone, our strong tower. Thank you that you are our very present help in time of need, that we can come to you, that we can lay our burdens at your feet, and you will take them because you care for us. Lord, we are in need of a great awakening. We are in need of breakthrough, Lord. So would you come with those rains of revival? Lord, you are the Prince of Peace, even in the time of war. And we are standing on our firm foundation, and we are believing that you are for us, that you have gone before us, and you are making a way where there seems to be no way. Lord, we need a touch from you. Would you have mercy on our nation? Would you have mercy on us as your children, Lord? We worship you. We honor you. And we give you all the praise. And it's in your name that we pray. Amen. If you joined us by standing in worship today, you can go ahead and have a seat, sit back, relax, and enjoy the message.
Thank you. Happy 4th of July weekend, everyone. As we celebrate our freedom as a nation this weekend, as a church, we want to recognize many who have sacrificed so that we may enjoy the freedoms and liberties we do today. As a nation, we can openly worship God and live under His design, whereby all are created equal. My name is Jenny, and I'm one of the worship leaders, and I want to welcome you to New Hope Windward Online. Thank you so much for tuning in with us today. Now, in a few moments, we'll have a great message for you, so I'd like to encourage you to share this link and invite a friend, coworker, or family member to join us for the message today. But before we get into today's message, we're going to take some time to worship God through our giving. With COVID-19 impacting every segment of our world, resulting in mass unemployment, Hawaii has one of the highest percentage of unemployment in the nation. Now, as a result, we've seen a massive increase in the number of individuals and families in need, and several local organizations have now become critical sources of food for many. Now, New Hope Windward financially supports several of these ministries, such as the Salvation Army, River of Life, and the Hawaii Food Bank on an ongoing basis. Yet, as a church, we wanted to do our part to provide essential food items to meet the huge need in our community. So we launched our own drive-through food pantry. Now, every Saturday for the past 6 weeks, in total, we distributed over 6,000 pounds of food to families in need. 6,000 pounds! Now, we estimate we provided approximately 1,000 families in need, and 35% of those families are a part of our New Hope Windward Ohana Church. Your selfless and sacrificial giving, whether you gave financially or dropped off food items, have helped to make a huge difference in the lives of many. Now, whether you feel like you're making a difference or not, I can assure you that many, many families have been greatly blessed because of you. So thank you for remaining faithful and generous in your giving towards God. And He honors everything that you do for His glory. So thank you, New Hope Windward, for your incredibly sacrificial hearts to look beyond your own needs and help make a kingdom difference in the lives of others. Now, at the bottom of your screen, you'll see three easy, safe, and secure ways to donate. By clicking the Give tab on our website, you can give a one-time gift or have it recurring. Another way is by texting the word donation to the number on your screen and follow the instructions. Or, if you prefer, you can mail in your gift and you can send it to the address below. Now, would you bow your heads with me as I lead us in prayer? Jesus, in these uncertain times, thank you for being our faithful provider, for being our constant companion in this season. We know that in you we lack nothing. Thank you for the leadership of this church who partner with your heart in all that you want to do. Thank you for all the different ministries who continue to help families in need. And Lord, thank you for the many in our church who continue to give so generously to those who are struggling during this pandemic to provide food and all that they need for their families. Our heart is to always be obedient in what you've called us to. So Lord, would you take what is given today and use it for your kingdom purposes here on earth? We honor you through our giving, and it's in your mighty name that we pray. Amen. Well, if you're joining us for the first time, we want to welcome you to our New Hope online community, and we'd love to keep you informed with all that's going on at New Hope Windward. Simply text Starbucks to 484848, and we'll email you a Starbucks e-gift card as a way to say welcome to New Hope Windward. Now, I just have a few quick announcements to share. Now, this is just a friendly reminder for those of you who have children in kindergarten through the fifth grade. We have services that are specifically geared towards them with incredibly fun activities and lessons that will help them grow in their faith in Jesus. Now, on the homepage of our website, you will see a Kids Zone tab. Click on that link and it'll take you to all of our Kids Zone services. Now, for those in 6th through the 12th grade, we have cool high school and junior high services that will challenge you to be your very best for Christ, whether it's at home or with your peers. Now, on the homepage of our website, you'll see a high school and junior high tab. Just click on the link and it'll take you directly to our youth services. Well, I'm sure many of you are looking forward to regather again for our in-person services. I know I can't wait to worship together with all of you. And as we ramp up for our relaunch, our heart is to make sure that we provide the best possible regathering services for all of you. Now, one important way to do that is to make sure we have enough hands to make all parts of service come together. Now, that means we need your help. and lots of it. We could use some great hearts willing to help with greeting and counting people at the doors, help with people flow into the theaters called our theater hosts team, and cleaning our theater restrooms between and during services. Besides, I'm sure some of you might be experiencing a little cabin fever and are feeling the urge to get out and make a difference for Jesus. And so I'd like to invite you to jump in and help. Simply send an email to info@nhww.org to sign up. You'll experience joy that comes from serving Jesus. Now, we don't have a set date as to when we will be regathering for our in-person services, but if you'd like to receive weekly updates with our e-newsletter, you can email us at info@nhww.org and we'll keep you updated. Now, that's all the announcements that I have for today. Before we get into today's message, I'd like to again encourage you to invite someone to tune in with us today. Text or forward this message link and have them tune in for our services. Now, today we are kicking off our summer message series, and we have Pastor TJ sharing today's message with us. So wherever you're joining us from, would you join me in welcoming Pastor TJ?
Well, hello, and thank you for joining us today online at New Hope Windward, especially if it's your first time. My name is TJ. I have the privilege of... being one of the members of the teaching team here every so often at New Hope Windward. And, you know, I was thinking this last week, I realized... The first time that I got to become a regular part of this church and being able to teach was actually last July. And since it's actually the 4th of July weekend, you know what that means, don't you? It's my New Hope Windward birthday. All right. You know, I would throw you a little chihu at this moment, but I'm afraid after you hear my chihu, you would never invite me back, so we'll just leave that as it is. But hey, if you are just joining us, here's what you got to know about our church. You know, we are a church of imperfect people, just doing our best to love God and love each other. And it's awesome. We've got a bunch of campuses all over the island and a lot of online campuses. And we just want to say welcome to all of you guys. Now, I also want to say this to two of our campuses, those of you guys that go to Kailua, as well as those of you guys that are at the Windward Mall Regal Cinemas campus. Everybody's been asking, hey, when are we going to be regathering? Matter of fact, we heard that Regal was going to be opening in the middle of July. Well, we just got word this week that although they were going to open in the middle of July, they actually had to push it back due to a lot of the stuff happening with COVID. So we don't have specific dates on either one of those of when we're going to regather. But until then, we're going to just keep you updated week to week, and we will continue meeting online together as a church family. Now, today, since it is July, it means that we get to start our summer series. And that's pretty awesome because what it does is it allows us to hear from different people and they'll share just kind of different things that God's going to put on their heart. And I get to kick it off. And there's something specific that I just felt like I wanted to share with everybody, whether it's your first time at church or you've been here 1,000 times. And what I want to do is I just want to speak something over you, meaning I just want to read this scripture because I really feel like there's a part of it that God just wanted to highlight for us here this morning. So here, this is from Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. It's coming from the NLT, and it says this. It says, we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. Now, the word I felt like we were really supposed to focus on today is this word masterpiece. And the reason for that is that whole masterpiece thing is I really feel like something that God wants to speak to you and speak to me. And this is basically what he's saying, is that when it comes to your life, when it comes to who you are, what he's doing is he is creating a masterpiece. You are meant to be a masterpiece. There is a version of you that exists, that when it functions as it's supposed to function, it's just like absolutely stunning. It's a blessing, not only to just those immediate around you, but just to the world around us. Now, for me, when I hear that, one of the things that I think of is I think to myself, hey, you know what? I don't know if I'd call myself a masterpiece. Master of disaster? Oh, absolutely, you know, or maybe like a hot mess, but masterpiece? I don't know about that. But the truth is even though that's how I feel, you know, what the scriptures say about me is the scriptures say that I'm a masterpiece. And that's what they say about you as well. And you know, honestly, we need each and every one of us to become the best versions of who we're supposed to be, that version of you that God is creating. And it's not just for us as a church. It's really like your family needs to be, have you be the best version of you. Like your workplace, because what you do is important. Like God has purposes for us. Our friendships, I mean, just in every space, what we're meant to be is to be exactly who God created us to be. Now, the question is how do we actually do that? And that's what I want to look at here this morning. And I want to do it by this, is I want to ask us a quick question. And if you know me, when I teach, I tend to ask a lot of questions. And the question I ask you is this, is what stops you from becoming you? You know, like that picture of who you know God created you to be, those dreams that he's put in your heart. Like, what's stopping you from becoming you? Now, many of us are going to answer this in many different ways. Some of us might say, you know, it's just different circumstances. Like, can I be honest? I just feel like a lot of it's money. Like, I don't have the money to do what I feel like I'm supposed to do. Or I just feel like actually I'm spending all my time working because it's so expensive here in Hawaii or wherever you live. Just working two jobs to stay afloat. For others of us, we'll say, you know what's stopping me is it's just time. I just have no more time. I've got kids. Everything's just going. It's just nonstop. Or maybe for you, you start thinking of a particular person, you know, somebody in your family maybe, or a boss, or maybe you even think of like a political leader or situation. I don't know what it is, but for many of us, we're going to point at all these things that stop us from becoming us. Now, it's true. Those things will have an effect on us. But when you actually look at Scripture, it's going to tell us that those aren't the biggest things that are stopping us from becoming us. It's not our circumstances. It's not people around us. It's something else. That there's two things that we've got to overcome if we're going to become who God created us to be. Now, to do this whole message this morning or this today, what I'm going to do is I'm going to use an analogy, and the analogy is this. I'm going to use an analogy of boxing. You know, in seventh grade, I got so into boxing. Like, I mean, just over the top, all about boxing. Now, let me clarify. I never actually boxed a day in my life. And when I say I got into boxing, what that really means is I watched Rocky, and I thought Rocky is the best thing ever, so I pictured myself as a boxer. So I never actually boxed, but it's a good analogy that's going to help us understand the Scriptures today. So here's how it's going to work. We're going to kind of walk through it. I'll kind of tease out some of these things, and it'll help everything kind of make sense. So when it comes to boxing, one of the questions you ask is this, is then who are you fighting against? Like if you're trying to become who you're supposed to be and something's coming against you, who are you actually fighting against? Now, for you, I don't know if this has ever happened to you, but when I was younger, I used to always think of like what my intro song would be. Well, let's be honest. I still think about that. And what would your intro song be if you came into a stadium? You ever thought of that? Chances are you are thinking of it now. But if it's me, this would be the song. In this corner, weighing in at 102 many pounds, T.J. Gorham! Can you see it with me? Huh? Okay, and then for my opponent. And facing him is? Who would be facing me? Or who would I be fighting against? I know some of you guys are a little bit shocked right now, like watching that, like what just happened? Well, this was my one chance in life to have that intro song actually happen. So I had to do it. But the point is not so much focused on who am I trying to become or how am I doing that, but what's actually stopping me? What's actually on the other side of the ring that I truly face? And Scripture is going to tell us we have two opponents. So let's take a look at these opponents, and we'll start here. The first one, believe it or not, is not anyone else. It's actually you. Listen, Pastor Dave touched on this last week, and I thought it was so good, but what the Scriptures will teach us is the first thing that we've got to overcome if we're going to become who God created us to be is actually ourselves. Says it like this out of Galatians. But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not carry out the desires of the flesh. For the flesh sets its desire against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. For these are in opposition to one another. One's on one side, one's on the other. So that you may not do the things that you please. Or as the New Living Translation puts it, which I like so well, this is the end part. It says this, These two forces are constantly fighting each other. So you are not free to carry out your good intentions. See, here's the thing. I know for each one of us that we all want to become who God created us to be. We have that desire. We have that intention. But what happens is that desire, that intention, that person is what the Bible calls the spirit version of ourselves. Because when you put your faith in Jesus and you become a Christian, there's actually two things that are inside of you. You have the flesh and you have the spirit. The flesh sets itself against what God's trying to do through your life. But the spirit is that masterpiece. It's the one that God's trying to bring forward. It only comes by what he's doing. And that's the one that we've got to figure out, how do we let that continue to grow and continue to become who we're supposed to be? Now, towards the end of this message, I'll give us some practical ways to kind of understand that. But for now, what you've got to understand is that both exist inside of you. And it's critical to kind of start to pause and to start to figure out, how do I know what each one of them look like? Listen, later this week, I want to encourage you to read Galatians 5. It's a great chapter that explains this in more detail. I'm just going to paraphrase it. But what it'll say is, listen, if you want to know what the flesh looks like, it looks like stuff like this. It's when you start to become really, really selfish. And you just think about only like my stuff and only me, me, me. Now, the spirit version of us, we want to be people that love our families well, that serve, that really bless the people around us. But when the flesh takes over, it really says it's all about me. Or another example of the flesh is when we start to become like envious. See, I know the masterpiece version, we want to be grateful. We want to be content with what we have and really be able to enjoy it. But when the flesh takes over, you start looking around at like what your neighbors have and you start to want it and to envy it. Or maybe you're on social media and you see what people are doing and it just makes you feel less content with your life. And what's going on there is the flesh is coming to life and it's fighting against what God's doing in our world. Outbursts of anger is the flesh. It's when we have other times where we have misaligned priorities. We start to put things above God, which is called idolatry. That's the flesh. But the spirit, it talks about in Galatians 5, it says this, it's love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control. I mean, these are the colors that God uses to paint masterpieces in all of our life. And those are the things that regardless of how you see yourself, once you put your faith in Jesus, you have access to these things. But it doesn't come easy. It's a little bit of a battle because the flesh and the spirit, they actually war against one another. And so when it comes to this whole thing of like the whole boxing analogy, listen, one of the things that we biggest opponents we fight is actually ourselves. But scripture also says that we actually, not only just us, but we actually have an enemy. Now, when I ask you a question and say like, who are your enemies or who's your enemy? Most of us, we might think of a specific person or maybe somebody who hurt us in the past or maybe a group of people that we consider like an enemy that's coming against us. But most of us would create an enemy with a person, like a human being. Scripture says that's not actually our chief enemy. Scripture says it like this out of Ephesians. It says, listen, you're not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers in this dark world, and against evil spirits in the heavenly places. In other words, what Scripture is trying to teach us is the world that we live in is not just a physical world. That there are spiritual forces in the same space, and sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes those will be the things that really come against us to stop us from becoming who God created us to be. Let me give you an example of how this might look. I'll use an example of like fear. Listen, sometimes fear is a byproduct of the flesh. We're all naturally afraid of different things, and sometimes we get paralyzed a little bit by it. But sometimes there's this like, almost like it feels like this oppression of fear that comes. It's when your mind just races out of control or your emotions start to just take off. And no matter what you try to do, it just feels like you're absolutely debilitated. Now in that moment, it may be the flesh, but in that moment, it might also be kind of like something of a spiritual nature in that. Now the good news is that if it is something of a spiritual nature, you don't have to be afraid. Because Scripture teaches us it's really easy to deal with these things. I don't mean easy like it won't be a battle, but I mean easy in the sense of like, God's going to help us to be able to overcome it. You don't have to worry about this being stronger, because it's not like Jesus and this darkness is the same level. It's like this. Jesus is so much higher that when he steps in a situation, he can just take care of it. And so what we have to be able to do, though, is we have to be able to understand, what is it that we're fighting against in this moment? Is it just me and my flesh, or is it also something else? And regardless of what it is, there's ways for us to deal with this. Now, here's why this is so important. It's critical that we really start to figure out who we're fighting against, because if we're not careful, what we're going to end up doing is we're going to actually end up calling somebody an enemy that might actually meant to be a teammate. I'll give you an example, a real simple one. Maybe for you, one of the biggest things that it's just so hard and you feel like this is why I just, it's hard for me to do what I'm supposed to do, is actually my spouse. See, one of the things that the enemy loves to do is to have a marriage and have a marriage couple see us as one person right here, and then your spouse over here in the opposite corner, and to see it where you're actually fighting against one another. But the truth is that when you took your vows, when you got married, it was not me against you. What it was meaning to be is that me and you are on the same team together. And together, we are going to constantly fight against whatever darkness would come our way. Or we are going to fight to become who God created us to be and to make the difference in the world that we're meant to make. But what happens over time, if we're not careful, is sometimes one of the teammates might have an issue. And over time, what will start to happen is if we're not careful, we'll start to look at them not as a teammate, but actually as an enemy. And when you start to look at them as an enemy, there's just like this lack of compassion that comes in. There's this lack of grace. Like when somebody's your teammate and they're having a hard time, isn't it true that you want to come alongside them and you want to help them? Yeah, I know you're having a hard time. I know you feel like you're letting the team down. And yeah, it's difficult, but you can do this. Like we can do this together. It's a we. But as soon as you see him as the enemy, there's no longer a we. It's me versus you. Satan loves that. The devil loves that. The enemy loves when that starts to happen. I mean, if you watch sports, like I love sports. And you might love sports too, back in the days when we could watch sports and they were on TV. But when you remember sports, the thing that was crazy is you could have an incredible sports team, play a terrible sports team, and this terrible team could win if this incredible team actually started to turn on one another. Because as soon as you turn on one another, man, you're so easy to defeat. And oftentimes, that's what happens to our families. That's what happens to our workplaces. It's not that like we don't have what it takes or that we're not on the right path. It's actually that we start to see each other as the enemy, and it just brings destruction in that space. It just happens all the time. Listen, you don't even have to be a church person to see that that's true. I mean, haven't you seen that before? Haven't you seen a family turn on one another? Haven't you seen a marriage go south when they don't see each other as together? Haven't you seen a workplace with such a toxic environment like that? And a lot of times the reason for that is because we don't know who we're actually fighting. And so what we do is we end up calling the wrong thing an enemy, and our perspective shifts, and then we end up attacking that space, and it fights against what it is that God's doing in those spaces. So who are the big enemies we're fighting against? Well, one is ourselves and our flesh. And the other is there's spiritual forces sometimes that come against us. So the question is in those times, what are we supposed to do? So what I want to do is continue my boxing analogy, and I'm going to give you this. I'm going to ask you, what are your go-to moves? And I'm going to give you a couple offensive moves. I'm going to call it this as the 1-2 punch to overcome. So just like in boxing, it's that 1-2. Now, let me just pause and say this. If you're watching this and you're a boxer, and the 1-2 punch isn't a thing, that's just a movie thing, I apologize in advance. I know you must be upset. And listen, I'm so sorry. If you want, you can write me an email. You can just let me have it. My email address is pastordave@newhopewindward.org. And please, feel free to make it as long as you want at this point. But the truth is this 1-2 punch, I think it's going to work as an analogy. Okay, here we go. The first thing you're going to do in these moments, whenever you're encountering a hardship, whenever you feel like something's stopping you from becoming who you're supposed to be, the first thing you're going to do, you're going to pause. You're going to pause, and here's why. When you pause, the first thing you're going to look for is that first opponent. You're going to ask yourself this question: am I living right now in the flesh, or am I living in the spirit? Am I living from a place of anger, envy, selfishness, frustration, whatever it is? Or am I living from a place of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness? Because if you're living in this place right here, the first thing you want to do in that situation is don't do anything. It's to actually pause, because you might think that the enemy is right in front of you, but the first enemy you got to overcome is actually right here. And whenever you're in the flesh, you don't think well. You make bad choices. I'll give you an example. I'll just use one that for me. I hate gossip. I'm guessing you hate gossip too. But imagine if you heard a group of your friends, you weren't there, and somebody gossiped about you. They told something that wasn't even true. Now, for me, when that happens, you know the first thing that kicks in? It's not the spirit, it's the flesh. I get upset. And I could just go to that person and I'd be tempted just to let them have it. Just, but if I pause, it's okay, what's going on? Is it okay to hate gossip? Yeah, it's okay to hate gossip. But the gossiper, you're not even sure if they actually said anything yet, because what you just heard is secondhand. So maybe you should just check in first. And you know, even if they did say something, isn't it true that you've said something before at some other time? Now, in that moment, I'm like, no, I've always said never. But the truth is, we've all done something like that, unintentionally or intentionally. And so if my spirit kicks in, I actually think about it a little more rationally. I'm actually able to deal with it. But if I just roll with the flesh, I've already kind of lost the battle, even though I'm not the one that did something wrong. That's the whole tricky thing about it. The flesh sometimes will react to things in a way just to make us attack and to go, and rather than to operate from where God wants us to operate. So the first thing you do is to pause. Am I functioning in the spirit, or am I functioning in the flesh? That's punch one. Punch two, to follow that up, is as you pause, the next thing you're going to do is you're going to pray. And this is what you're going to pray. You're going to say, God, I feel, whatever it is, just be honest, I feel afraid. I feel envious. I feel selfish in this moment. So name what it is, and you can pray against it. God, help me not to be afraid right now. Help me not to be selfish. So come against the one thing, and then instead of that, ask God for something else to replace it. So God, rather than be afraid right now, Lord, would you give me courage? Because fear is just debilitating me. In Jesus' name. Or God, rather than be angry, because I feel so angry, and what they did is really wrong. But Lord, would you help me to just have a sense of patience right now, or peace, so that I can even think clearly about what I'm supposed to do, what I'm supposed to say? I'm so mad at my kids. I just want to blow up. But God, give me peace, because I want to raise them the way that I'm supposed to, that you want me to raise them. In Jesus' name. And so you just stop and you just begin to pray. Now, for some of you watching this, I can just imagine, especially if you're not a Christian, saying like, wait a second. So you're telling me that if I get in some of these moments and I just pray, that something will change? Well, honestly, not all the times, but a lot of the times, yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, I've seen this happen over and over again. I have a friend, he's not a Christian and doesn't really want anything to do with God in the beginning, but he works in this really, really stressful environment. I mean, he basically is like, he just wants to walk around and false crack everybody. It's just so stressful. And he found out about this prayer thing and he tried it. And he just started praying. He says it was the craziest thing, because all of a sudden, it was like the same people in the same environment, but he went from just being like a rage monster, is what I think the phrase he used, to actually starting to have a little bit of like peace, and he was able to actually handle situations completely different. But the crazy thing is, nothing changed. It was the same people, same environment. The only thing that changed is he started to pray. And when he prayed, something started to change and to show up and to happen. Listen, if you're not a Christian, I just want to challenge you with this. It's like, if you were to pray in those situations, what's the worst that's going to happen? Like, what do you have to lose? Let's say that you're really angry and you pray and then nothing happens. Well, you're going to be probably just as angry as you were before, right? You're kind of in the same spot as you were. But what happens if you pray and all of a sudden you feel a sense of peace come over you? I mean, isn't it worth just trying? I mean, you don't have to even tell anybody. But what I'm telling you is that when you invite Jesus into certain situations, it's amazing how he can help you overcome the flesh in those moments of what's going on inside of our life. And so what you do is you pause, am I in the spirit or in the flesh? You pray, God, help me to not have the flesh and instead take the part of the fruit of the spirit that I need or whatever it is that I need in that moment, and you pray in Jesus' name. And a lot of times what you're going to see is the situation start to change. Now, I will be honest though, sometimes it won't change. And so what do you do in those times? Well, you can pray again, but I'll give you like my third step. So this is the 1-2, this one I guess I call like the haymaker or local version, like the false crack, the thing that's coming on in there. And this is the one I reach out to a lot. It's this: if I get into that situation, I call for backup. What does that look like? Well, for me, I've got certain people in my life that I can just be super honest with. Matter of fact, I reached out to one of the guys even today. Some situations going on inside of like my family, and I'm kind of like stressed on it and like that. And I'll call him up and I'll just be honest. Hey, dude, I'm so frustrated. This is what's going on. Like, can you just pray for me? Now, if I can be totally transparent, in the moments when I really need to reach out for backup, I never want to do it. I don't want to burden them. I feel weird. It's like pride kicks in. It's all these things. But in the moment, I've already prayed. I've already asked God to help me, but I just got so upset that either like my flesh is taken over or there's something else that's there. And it's just like, boom, this whole thing. And when I come to ask for backup, a lot of times my friend will come in and he'll be like, oh man, like, I totally hear you. Like in this situation though, can I be honest? I don't think this is like a spiritual thing as much. I just think it's your flesh. Matter of fact, in this situation, I kind of think you're wrong. So let's pray and like really take care of that. Now, when he says that, I get upset because I'm like, dude, I thought you were on my team. But the reality is he is being on my team, isn't he? Because my enemy is not a person. My enemy is not my spouse if it's my family or my boss if it's my work. It's my flesh inside of me and anything else funky going around it. Listen, sometimes Christians are notorious for doing this. Sometimes Christians, they come and they will talk about like the enemy or the devil, and they'll blame everything on the devil. Like, I yelled at my wife and the devil made me do it. And it's like sometimes, like my friend told me, it's like, I'm pretty sure that one's not the devil. I'm pretty sure that's you. You're just being a jerk right now. And it's just your flesh taking over on it. And so sometimes we over-spiritualize it. But other times, it's not. Other times we under-spiritualize and something else is in the mix. Now, the reality is regardless of if it's your flesh or if it's like the enemy in that space, this is still going to work. Pause, pray, and call for backup. God, if this is something else, if it's like a weird thing in here, I just pray against it in Jesus' name. Would your spirit fill this place? Would your spirit fill my family? Would your spirit fill my heart? Would your spirit fill my mind in Jesus' name? Hey, can you pray with me? They come and just pray like on the phone, even if it's just a text. But it is amazing to watch what happens when this kicks in. Because when you start to learn this 1-2 punch, you're going to start to actually overcome and take steps towards who God created you to be. And the truth of the matter is, that's what God wants for all of us. So I want to ask you again, just start to close. What's stopping you from being you? What's getting in the way of you becoming who God created you to be? Because whatever it is, I'm telling you this, God will help you. If you'll invite him into the situation, when Jesus shows up, part of what he's doing, Philippians 1:6, is he's continuing to change us day after day, more and more, into the masterpiece that he's created us to be. And it's going to be a journey. We're never going to get there. We're never going to be perfect. It's not about perfection. That's the other mistake. People think it's like, oh, I got to be perfect. It's not that. It's just you want to take one step forward more towards who you're supposed to be than you did yesterday. And he'll help you continue to do that. I want to end with one final scripture, and it comes from Romans, and it says this. It says, what then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? So in other words, what I want you to just realize with my boxing analogy is if you're a Christian, do you know who's in your corner? It's not just you. It's God. Like Jesus is literally with us. And we might feel overwhelmed and discouraged because we can't overcome something. But how many of you guys know when Jesus steps into the mix, there's nothing he can't overcome. There's nothing that can stop him. And granted, for some of us, our journey might take some time. It might be a battle for a while. But if Jesus is with you, I'm telling you, you will experience victory eventually. For me, this was a firsthand experience with this whole, I had this whole season of depression. And I'm not talking like a couple weeks of depression. It spanned like a couple years. And I tried to figure it out. I tried to eat right. I talked to different people. I tried to do exercise. I tried to like all the factors, but some of that helped a little bit, but it just felt like this weight. And so I would pray. I would pause. I would pray. I would invite God. I'd have other people pray. And it was just like this battle. And if I could be perfectly honest with you, I thought it was never going to change. But I can tell you today, standing on this side of it, that I am absolutely certain that God comes through. But we just have to continue to stay in the fight. And for some of you today, that's what you needed to hear. It's that, man, you're doing a good job. Just hang in there. Stay in the fight. Don't grow weary in doing good. Because at a proper time, you're going to receive a harvest or you're going to receive a breakthrough. And God just wants you just to continue. And he's in there with you. He's got your back. He's going to bring other people. But we got to get this rhythm down where we pause and then we pray. And then we know who's the person that you call for backup. Who's your go-to? I have three. And I know I'm going to hit them up even when I don't want to, because there's times it feels really hard. And in this COVID season, I imagine for a lot of us that I'm not the only one. But when we do this, even in hard seasons, God will use those seasons to help us take a step forward into who he created us to be. And he'll use these seasons to continue to paint the masterpiece that is our life, that is who we're supposed to become. And when Jesus came and he died on the cross, he made a way that's possible for all of us. Listen, the biggest secret to being able to do this is when you start to realize that you don't have what it takes to overcome these opponents on your own. That you don't have what it takes to overcome your flesh. That you don't have what it takes to overcome anything that comes against you. One of the biggest mistakes for people in and outside of the church is to think that they can handle on their own. Because the truth is, you can't just control this stuff. It needs to be defeated. And the only one that has the power to defeat it is really Jesus. And when we put our trust in him, it says his spirit comes and lives in us. And it allows us to overcome the flesh. It allows us to overcome whatever comes against us. And for some of you here today, you need to remember that. You're a Christian already, but you've gone back to relying on your own strength. And today, God's inviting you to say, don't just trust in yourself, come and trust in me. Pause, invite me into the situation through prayer, partner with others, and I will give you victory. For others of you, you're just been checking out church, and it's an awesome thing. I'm really glad you're here, and you're welcome to be here. We love having you. And maybe you've learned some really great things about like relationship skills or how to control some emotions and things. But if I can be honest with you, those things are good, but really the source of this whole thing is Jesus. It's being able to say, hey, listen, I don't have what it takes, and inviting Jesus into a situation. And he's the one that changes stuff. We play a role in it, but he's the one that really is the source of the whole thing. And what I want to do to close today is just lead us in a time of prayer where we can all just center back to Jesus. And to recognize that, man, okay, I know who the enemies are and I know who the enemies aren't and I know who's in my corner, and I'm going to move forward into who God created me to be by pausing, by praying, and then by calling for backup. So if you can, wherever you are, if you're watching this on your phone, in your living room, would you just find a space and we're just going to pray together, because I really believe God wants to do some work in all of us here today. So would you bow your heads with me as we close in prayer? You know, Father, thank you for who you are. God, thank you for having a plan for our life, for what your word says, that you really are creating a masterpiece, that you've created us on purpose. And Lord, I know for many of us, it's hard to even see that in ourselves, but thank you that you see in us what we can't see in ourselves. Thank you that you birth in us what we can't do on our own, that we can't birth ourselves. And Lord, I want to pray for all my friends everywhere that, God, that as we come to you today, Lord, that we would come afresh and just say, God, you know, a lot of us were tired. We've gone back to fighting the battle on our own strength, or we've gone to, you know, fighting this battle, and it's just been such a long battle, we just want to give up, Lord. I know there's some things, it's like sometimes if I'm honest, I just want to give up. God, I pray that you would just give us strength today. In the name of Jesus, that you would breathe strength, that you would help us to gird ourselves up, that our spirit would come alive, and that we would continue to press forward. Because, God, you bring victory. It's not if you're going to bring victory, it's when. So, Lord, help us to continue to hang in there and to stay in the fight and to hold on to one another. And I also feel like there's some of you watching here that maybe you've never put your faith in Jesus or you've never invited Jesus in. And one of the things we want to do is we want to always make an opportunity for that at New Hope Windward. And so if that's you, here's what we're going to do. I want to lead you in a prayer. And here's what you'd be saying. Not that you have your life together, not that you're perfect, not that you got everything fixed, but you're just basically coming to Jesus saying, Jesus, I can't do this on my own. I've tried. I'm done doing it my way. Now I want to do it your way. See, the scripture says that Jesus came, and when he died on the cross, he did so to cover everything that we've done wrong. He did so to make a way for us to be connected back to God. And if we put him and if we follow him, it says that we will be reconnected to him, we'll be saved, and that God will transform us from the inside out and to start painting that masterpiece. And if you want to do that today, I'm going to lead you in a prayer. I'm going to give you some of the words. The words aren't magic words. It's more important in your heart. But I'm just going to lead you in the words. You just repeat after me and you put your heart and we'll just pray together. So you can do that right now. And if you're watching this, you're a Christian, you need to recommit your life, you can do that as well. So let's pray together. Say, Father, dear Lord Jesus, thank you for dying on a cross for me. I know I made mistakes and I'm sorry. Today I choose to follow you, to invite you into my life, to be my Lord, to be my Savior, and to be my leader. Help me to follow after you all the days of my life. And God, help all of us to follow after you all the days of our life, God. We love you, we praise you, we worship you. And all God's people said, amen, amen. Hey, thanks for joining us today here at New Hope Windward. You know, we're going to continue in this summer series. Someone else is going to share next week. I want to encourage you to check it out. You also can take any of these messages and share them with whoever you want. Also, we're going to just close today just in one final worship song. And so you can feel free to hang out and to worship with us. But other than that, we will see you guys next week.
You give. The Lord is so good. Can we say amen to that? Thank you so much for joining us today. We hope that you all have a great week. God bless.